Infosys provides world-class online IT training, staffing, and software testing solutions to customers worldwide. H2K Infosys, how we are different from our competitors. 100% job-oriented training, hands-on project work, cloud test lab, resume preparation and review, mock interviews, robust syllabus, one-time fee and lifetime access to classes, access to recorded sessions of live classes. H2K Infosys has won the trust of thousands of students worldwide. For a free demo class, visit us at h2kinfosys.com.
Meanwhile, let me know like what will be the output of my mapper and how it will go to my reducer. Okay, so later on you can try at your home to write how to write the pseudocodes and all on Java. Just let me know the flow through, like how it will be flowed through mapper to reducer and how you will get the output. Is it fine, Rahul? Okay, cool. So let's go to our PPT first. Okay, so today we will start discussing about APIs. So API is nothing but application programming interface, right? So when Hadoop was started earlier, we had an older version of API. So the format and look and feel of our MapReduce program was quite different when compared to our new API. So when Hadoop, the latest version of Hadoop, that is 0.20 versions were released, the new API have been introduced with those versions. So earlier to 0.20, in the sense 0.19 and 1.8 have old APIs itself. So whatever the companies, they have of started working on Hadoop from quite long period, they used to have programs in older versions of APIs only. So what they are doing right now is they have started writing the code, rewriting. Or I can say like they have started rewriting all the code which includes all these new API formats. So why actually the new API have been introduced? It is designed to make the API easier to evolve in the future. So if you just try to compare the new API versus old API, the code that we are writing will be a bit less, and also the kind of information it shows you is very abstract. I mean, it's suppose if you write 10 lines in your older API version, it is enough that you write only 8 lines in your new API. So that's where the beauty of APIs start. And the new API is type incompatible, as I told you. So everything needs to be rewritten to take the advantage of our new API. And coming to the second point, favors abstract classes over interfaces. So in the sense, we can add a method to our abstract class without breaking older implementations of our class. So adding up of new classes is very easier here. And here mapper and reducer itself are abstract classes. But if you see the older phases, you will give it as extends phase with implementations. But here the mappers and reducers were written in a different way. We will see it in our next slide. Okay, the old API was deprecated. So as of now, if anyone is trying to write new programs in Hadoop, or if any company is trying to start any new project, they are not concentrating on the old APIs, since everything needs to be converted at least in the later time. So they have started writing the programs in our new API itself. However, the new API is not still stable and future complete in Hadoop 0.20x. This particular point, I'm not going to support it, because as of now, if you see today, it's very stable as well. I mean, this was the story which was behind at least 6 months back, but now it is very stable and people are started using new API also. Okay, the old API should not have been deprecated as quickly as when new one is introduced. You can have this point as a generic point only, in the sense, if any new version or if any new thing comes into picture, just directly don't jump into it and start using it. So as we had discussed about the earlier Java versions or whatever the type of operating system that we are going to use, whenever a new thing is introduced, just don't jump into it, right? So as of now, the stabilized versions of Ubuntu or CentOS are only used, but not the latest versions of Ubuntu or CentOS are not being used in the companies. So that is what is being followed when it comes to APIs processing as well. So let's see few differences between old API versus new API. So if you see the first command itself, the importing statement itself is changing between old API versus new API. So in new API, I'm using it as hadoop.mapreduce.star. So all the packages or all the libraries that were related to MapReduce can be imported through hadoop.mapreduce in new API, whereas I will be using hadoop.mapred. Okay, coming to the driver code, if you see the configuration, I will use it as jobconf in our driver code when in my old API, whereas I will use it as configuration in my new API. So the next statement would be job is equal to new job conf, right? So I am extracting all these conf object properties into my job, and then I will set the class names by set chart by class. But here I will give it the class properties here itself in my job conf statement, right? I will give it as conf comma driver dot class name. So if at all the name changes, I will just change it here, but here it will be read by job by class. Okay, also I just wanted to let you know, like in our old APIs, there is a mechanism called as push and pull style of iteration. So what push function is doing is the it reads all the key value record pairs and they were pushed to the mapper phase in our old API. So that needs to be manually pushed by some of our taken care by our framework. But when it comes to new API, the mapper itself will pull the records using the map function. So here the framework doesn't need to take care of it. So when I write a map function using my new API, it will pull all the required records and it will process it. And also the same function with reducer also. So once the map functionality is given, the reducer will directly pull all the key value pairs. Of course, there is shuffle and sort phase in between, but once everything is ready and everything, the shuffling and sorting is done, the map phase, I mean the reduce phase, will automatically pull all the key value pairs. So using this process, records can be processed in batch mode rather than executing one by one, because if it is done in a map manual phase, like the pushing of key value pairs, it can be done only a step by step process. But when it comes to that functionality taken over by our mapper or reducer, they can process it in multiple versions, right? So it can pull it in batch mode itself. So it can, maybe it can pull some 10 to 20 key value pairs at a single moment, and it can process them at a single point of time. And coming to the job client, here the control is taken care by the job itself, whereas in the old API, the job control is performed by job client. So in the new API, I am using a new class itself called as job class. So that class itself is going to take care all that functionality of taking the controls and pulling up the data or information, whatever needed, once and when the client submits the job. And coming to the mapper phase, as I told you, the abstraction takes advantage in our new API. So in our old API, we use it to write the program as public class MyMapper extends MapReduce base implements mapper. But here directly I can give it as public class MyMapper. So MyMapper is nothing but my mapper name. So I can give anything in it, public class MyWish.name, something like that, extends mapper. And then once you go into the main function public void map, the key and value remains the same, but in mapper phase we had a, in our older version we had an output collector and reporter where it will collect all the key value pairs that were produced by my mapper. So output collector is a class where it gets stored, where it stores all my key value pairs, and reporter is the one which will let us know internally like, okay, I had collected all the key value pairs. But this functionality has been taken care only by a single class called as context. So context is the phase, or you can consider it as a class or even something object which is used to communicate with the map and our reduce systems. So this is the guy who is going to communicate with our mappers and reducer faces, like, okay, I had collected all the key value pairs and it is at this position, and reducer can read all these key value pairs from this particular point or something like that. Okay, so and here I will use it as context.write to write all the values, and here I will take it as output.collector. So I will write as o.collector, and in the new API I will write it as c.write. So that's what few differences between our old API and new APIs. So let's start discussing about how to get the data into the mapper. So there is something internally happening apart from discussing about the input splits. So we will look at it. Okay. So let me ask you a question. How mapper is getting the key value pairs for mapper? So on a high level, if we think, it is done by the framework, right? But still, if we go internally and think about it, the our input format is the one which specifies how to get these key value pairs, right? So the data passed to the mapper is specified by an input format, and this input format is specified in our driver code. So if you think our driver code, there we are setting up the mapper class name, reducer class name, and my input format, on my output format, and the key format for my mapper, and value output format from my mapper class, and then key and value outputs from my reducer. So these are the things I am going to give in my driver class, right? I mean, at least these are the mandatory things. Apart from that, we can give so many things, like I can specify my own partitioner, or I can specify my own combiner, or whatever it might be. But few things that are mandatory are the above ones which I told you, right? So the functionality of our input format is divided into three phases. The first one is it will validate the input location. So it will see whether the location is available or not, and if it is available, it will go and check whether it has some input data or not. So once it has validated that, okay, the input location is fine and we are able to see the input file, the second function what it's going to do is it will create the input splits. So if you remember, input format is the one who is responsible for creating our input splits, right? So based on the record sizes and based on the values, based on the amount of data our input file is having, it will divide it into our input splits, and also taking the block size into consideration, it will try to create the input splits as much close to our block size. So and the third functionality is it creates the key value pairs, and it will pass it to the respective mappers. So it may pass it as such as the respective mappers may be called as, so I am trying to just let you know the default type, byte offset dot value. So this is the default one which we had discussed, right? So if you take the above example itself, the key value pairs to my mapper will be passed as byte offset comma value, in the sense 0 comma hi how are you, and next maybe just imagine that how are you has been ended at position 25. So the next record will be processed as 26 comma where hi, where have you been these days, and the next record might be some 42 comma where can I find you. So that is how the key value pairs are going to be divided in our default format, so that it is nothing but byte offset comma value. So each mapper deals with a single input split. So once we are ready with our input splits, the actual map phase will come into picture. So each map phase will take each of the input split, and till this point we are aware of what happens, right? So we had discussed all these things till this point. So the next point which is going to be introduced is input format creates record reader objects to extract key value records from the input source. So record reader is a guy who is responsible for reading records from the input splits in the form of key value pairs. So there should be some intermediate object or something else such that we will be able to read them in the form of key value pairs. So the default one is mappers comma byte offset dot value, right? So if at all I want to read it in another form, maybe I want to take my first word as key itself. So if you take my first line, hi should be my key and how are you should be my value. And coming to the next one, where should be my key and have you been these days should be my value. So if at all I want to read it in this format, I have to declare a special record reader in my program such that it will record it, it will read it in this phase. Okay, but everything actually, if you go by default, everything is abstracted. We cannot see that anywhere, right? But if you go into our advanced MapReduce functions or something like that, that is where we will get all these into picture. So there you will write your own record reader setups, or you will write your own partitioners, combiners, or few input formats also you will try to declare for yourselves. So all those are user defined functions, and all these will come into picture only when you write programs in your advanced MapReduce. But the simple MapReduce programs will just directly use the default functions. Okay. So if we see our MapReduce in a big picture, the first one what it happens is we will get the input file. So if you see this picture, my first input file was divided into three input splits, and the next input file is divided into only one input split. So after it is divided into splits, the next functionality is there should be someone who will able to read our input splits in the form of key value pairs, right? So the input format, in our input format we have a record reader such that it will read all our input splits in the form of key value pairs, and once it is ready with that format, it will send all these values to our mapper function. So for each of the input split there will be internally a default record reader which it will convert into key values, and then our mapper phase starts, and we all know what happens once we start with our mapper phase, right? So it will create some intermediate key value pairs, and then if at all it is needed, I will go into partitioner and I will do whatever the shuffles and shortings that were needed. So don't worry about this partitioner, we will discuss once this particular information is, or once this particular portion of our syllabus is finished. Okay, so just right now just imagine there is one partitioner internally used, and after that there will be our reducer functionality. So our reducer functionality will give our final output values, right? So but once it comes to reducer, there will be something more called as record writer. So record writer is another reducer. So for each reducer we will have a record writer object, and it is responsible for writing outputs from our reducer in the form of key value pairs. And there is something called as output format. Guys, are you able to hear me? Hello. 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 Guys, are you able to hear me? Hello. Okay. Okay. School. Okay. So record writer is the guy or he is the object which will be able to process our final key value pairs. And after that there is something called as output format which is responsible. So the functionality of output format is not much critical like our input format. So the output format is just used to responsible or it is just responsible for writing the outputs from our reducer. So here this record writer and record reader, there is nothing specific to our Hadoop system. It is just all our Java programs, right? So internally all these functionalities will be written in the form of Java code only. So if you want to overwrite those things, it's nothing but you have to extend those Java programs so that you can build it of your own. So if you take our OutCount example itself, so because of the default output format we are having the key and values. So my default record writer and record reader, what it is saying is display the output in key comma value pairs such as it is divided by a tab. So this is the default one that was given in our record reader and writer. So and that is the reason. So if you observe or if you remember the word count output program, you had seen like key space and some value, right? It is not displayed as key comma value, right? So whatever the outputs we got, it was in the form of high space 2, house space 3. So it is all tab separated, right? So this tab separated is the default one and it was decided by our default record readers. So it's up to my wish, like if I want to display them in the form of highest to 2 or how equal to 3 or something like that. So it's up to me. But I had used the default one and that's the reason I had got the output as high space 2 and how space 3. Not particularly space, high tab 2 and how tab 3. So that is what the functionality of record reader and writer. And so let's also discuss about our input formats. So there are different kinds of input formats. So if you see the most used input formats, we have different things. So the default ones are text input format, key value input formats and sequence file input formats. I mean these are at least highly used input formats in our MapReduce programs. So the default one is just the text input format what we had discussed till now. So what it will do is the key will be the byte offset of the line and the value is the line contents itself, right? So if you see the text input format, if you have the text in this form, on the top of the crumpetty tree, the quangle wangle sat, but his face you could not see on account of his beaver hat. So if this is the record I had got it in my input split, it will be divided into one split of four records. So this whole thing will be taken as one single split, and it was divided into four records. So the four records will be divided only with the byte offset itself. So it will start with zero, and that's the reason I have it as zero comma on the top of Krumpty tree, and then after that the next position 33 comma something values, and so on so forth. So this is what the default we had seen till now. So if you see the next one, which is key value text input format, what it says is, unlike text input format key input formats, key is the offset within the file. Keys are also the actual values within the file. So key is nothing but some part of my input record itself. So it's not the byte offset here. So it will be, I can decide like the first word will be my key. So as we discussed, if you see the same input example, it will be taken as, suppose if my input line is having as line 1 on the type of the, on the top of the Krumpty tree, line 2 the Quangle sat, in the above data this particular arrow will be represented as a tab character. So if I specify the separator as a tab itself, so the key will be formed as line comma 1, and the next the value will be formed as on the top of the Krumpty tree. So first, after every first tab, I want to divide it into key comma value. So all the contents before my tab should be key, and all the contents after my first tab should be my value. So if I say in that way, my output would be in the form of line 1 comma on the top of the Krumpty tree, line 2 comma the Quangle sat, line 3 comma but his face you could see, and line 4 comma on account of his beaver hat. So all these things you can specify through mapReduce.input.keyValueLineRecorder.keyValueSeparator property. So the default one is the tab character, and that's the reason I had shown you this example. But it's up to you, like which particular point you want to use instead of your tabs. You may be using @ or $, exclamatory mark. It's up to you what you want to use. But that particular functionality you can override it through our mapReduce.input.keyValueLineRecorder.key.value.separator. So we have to give this in our configuration files, right? So any questions on this? Excuse me. Okay. So the next one is N-line input format. With text input format and key value text input format, each mapper receives a variable number of lines of inputs. The number depends on the size of the split and the length of the line, right? So suppose if you take my old example itself, it depends on how many records I want to process in this particular input split based on the size of how much I am dividing for each of the input split. So by default I have to process whole input split itself. I cannot stop somewhere in between in processing the input split, right? So but when it comes to N-line input format, the case is different. So if you want your mappers to receive a fixed number of lines of input, then N-line input format is the right guide to use. Okay, like text input format, the keys are the by offsets within the files and values are the lines themselves. So it is nothing but equal to our text input format. So the dividing of key and value is nothing but same, but how many records you want to process in your particular input split, on that one you can have your control with our N-line input format. So if you take this particular same example, N refers to number of lines of input that each mapper receives. With N set to 1, the default one, so the default is only one record will be processed through my mapper. So with N set as 1, each mapper receives exactly one line of input. The mapReduce.input.lineInputFormat.linesPerMap property controls this value of N. So again I can have some control on this value, where I can give it in my configuration directories. So If, for example, n is 2, then each split contains 2 lines. So, the whole split is divided into 2 splits itself. So, it's up to me like how much quantity of data I want to process at a single point of time using this n-line input format. So, one mapper will receive the first 2 key value pairs, that is 0, comma on the top of Krumpty tree and 33, comma the quangle wangle sat. And the next mapper will receive the remaining 2 lines. So, the dividing of key value pairs is same as well as text input format. But how much I want to process, that I can control through my n-line input format. So, let's see something more about input formats. So, there is something more called as sequence file input format. So, sequence file format stores all kind of binary key value pairs. Okay, so if at all I want to process some binary data, then this particular kind of format will come into picture. So there are 2 kinds in it. The first one is sequence file as text input format, sequence file as binary input format. So the default one is they will be processed only through text formats only, but in very few cases or maybe some through image processing or somewhere, those can be processed only when it is converted into binary formats. So for image processing and all those things also, I can write my MapReduce programs, but how I will process them is different when it comes to some image processing or PDFs processing or something like that. But in most of the projects and most of the cases, we will be doing our analysis on the text files itself. But in some cases, we will be using the images as well. So at that moment, this sequence file input format will come into picture. So sequence file as text input format, what it does is, it is a variant of sequence file input format only. So it is form of our sequence files. So all these files will be read sequentially in the form of key value pairs, whereas it will internally converted into binary formats. So the sequence file input format converts the sequence file keys and values to text objects, and the conversion is performed by some function called as toStrings on the keys and values. So this is used when we are processing our image files, but internally it will, all the binary values will be converted into text objects. But if I want to process that binary files only in the form of binary formats only, then I will go ahead and use sequence file as binary input format. So sequence file as binary input format is a variant again of our sequence file input format that retrieves the sequence files keys and values as opaque binary objects. So don't worry about this processing of image. So we have few more slides on how we are going to process this image files as well. So at that moment I will talk much more about this sequence file input formats. But as of now, just remember that all the sequence files input formats will be processed in the form of key value pairs, and it is divided into binaries only. So any questions till now? So we will try to wind up today. Have a question. One second. Can the input value to mapper be a list collection as opposed to text? So Rahul, I mean, what do you mean by the list comma collection? So you want to mention it like all keys and values were kept at one single way as a single key and value and processed at a single point of time? Is that your question? So are you asking as hi, how, or all these forms the key? Ah shit. For example, key, the value is a list of number of examples. No, for mapper, this is not the case, because mapper will read everything as one single and one value. For each key, the value is a list of numbers, for example. This list of numbers. So if you see this example, hi, how are you? The keys and values would be as delete. Okay, the keys and values would be in the form of 0, and the value itself is, it is taken as a single line, hi, how are you? It is not divided into separate parts. So it's in my input mapper functionality, I will try to distribute or unstring my whole line, right? So but for mapper, it is a single input line. So is that your question or it is something else? Okay, fine. So for before going into the map functionality, it don't have anything in it in his mind other than start from read from this position to read till this position as a single value. So it will take everything whatever you write over there as a single one value. But inside my mapper function, I will try to divide it or I will try to read it separately depending on my requirement. Okay. So guys, any other questions? Okay. So fine guys, let's wind up for today. So tomorrow we will discuss about some output formats as well on a very high level, and from tomorrow onwards we will start discussing on partitioner. Okay, so that is one of the major topic that we have to discuss in MapReduce, and there is much more to talk on partitioner, but it's just not a single line what we discussed till now. Okay. Fine. Thank you all for joining. Let's meet tomorrow at the same time. Okay.
H2K Infosys provides world-class online IT training, staffing, and software testing solutions to customers worldwide. H2K Infosys, how we are different from our competitors. 100% job-oriented training, hands-on project work, cloud test lab, resume preparation and review, mock interviews, robust syllabus, one-time fee and lifetime access to classes, access to recorded sessions of live classes. H2K Infosys has won the trust of thousands of students worldwide. For a free demo class, visit us at h2kinfosys.com.